Thank you for inviting me today. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm very excited because it's the first time I'm coming to the Future Cities Lab. So I'm looking forward to discovering even more the laboratories and the different spaces, the exhibition and so on. But before that, I would like to share with you few things that we have been doing at the office, and also something that is more our spirit. So today I would like to share with you observing global, thinking regional, living local. And it is something that is even more present since I am French, living in for 7 years, practicing in an Asian context, and also having an office in Paris. So, as you mentioned before, Aurel, in 2010 I opened this architectural studio in Singapore, WITO. In English, we can say Y2. And a few months later, my business partner, Pauline Gaudry, opened the French studio in Paris. So this is me, I'm very tall, and this is her, she's very short. But we go well along together for many, many years because we started to work together more than 12 years ago when we met each other in Hong Kong. So since then, we have been developing many different things at the office. And so here you can see the different disciplines that we are having. So architecture, exhibition design, which is an important part at the office, some curatorial work, we are museum specialists, interpretive planning. I'm also a teacher, we do some lighting design. And on top of that, we do sustainable design, which is very important in 2016. So this is of our different areas of activities in Europe, in India. We started to work in India a few months ago, and of course in the Southeast Asian region, Singapore, and in Indonesia. So a sustainable approach contributes to a living environment that is more generous and less anonymous. It is something that is very important for us at WITO when we develop our project, to always keep in mind a sustainable approach, but oriented to the people, to the users. So I will start first with this project. So you will see that I will share with you some project from a very small scale to a very large scale, both in Asia and in Europe. So to provide an adapted response to the local context. So we are working currently on this living shelter for disaster relief. It is a project that we are developing with some partners in Singapore. We have been we obtained a grant from Design Singapore to present our project in the Venice Architecture Biennale, because we had been selected by Alejandro Aravena to present our prototype there. So this is what I would like to share with you today. So in Asia and the Pacific region, we have almost 43% of all of the disasters that are happening Earth. So it's quite a lot compared to the rest of the world, and even more with our neighboring countries. So we are pretty lucky here in Singapore. We are not hit by any disaster compared to the Philippines or Indonesia, and so on. So what kind of response we can provide as architects to what is happening in the region? So it is our responsibility to help the others with our skills. So here it's a different example of what is happening in the region. And on that map, it's actually the number of people who died or are homeless, and what can we do as architects when we observe that, when we witness that. And here Singapore, no disaster. So what can we do from here? The needs when a disaster happens, right after the disaster, the needs are to provide some shelter that are safe and comfortable, to provide sanitation and hygiene, medical, logistic and support, and on the long term, to provide an education with schools. So this is the response that we have in the region when a disaster happens, tent, which are entirely not adapted to the local context. So those pictures are not pictures taken in the region, but you can see that this is exactly what is being sent by NGOs when an earthquake or a tsunami happens. And the people basically don't use them because it is too hot. We live in a context where it is hot and humid, so those tents are used for storage. And people are still in the street, outside, or in between the buildings that are still existing somehow. So what can we provide for that? So the ideal requirement of a shelter, enclosure. Enclosure because also what is happening, there is a phenomenon that women are being raped after a disaster because they would have lost their husband, their family, so they are left alone. Women and kids are being raped. So this is not mentioned in the different news because it is something that is untold. So, but all of the NGOs are well aware of that, so they are looking for solutions to protect the people and to give them a proper enclosure for them to start recovering from the disaster. Daylight, electricity, water, ventilation, and so on. Of course, cooking, it is something extremely important for the recovery. So we looked at the typical tropical house. So you will start to see the link with the sustainable approach. That we looked at the kampung house, so for the one who knows what is a kampung, if you don't know what is a kampung, it's a village, traditional village. So we looked at the vernacular architecture, being on stilts, natural ventilation, large roof eaves to protect against the heavy rain. So those are very simple principles that are important to develop for a simple shelter. So we looked into how to bring those shelters into all of the disaster areas. So we looked at the cargo to bring that there to this shipping container and to propose a flat pack that can be unfolded on site. Currently, IKEA is working on that. They developed their flat pack that is, once again, not adapted to the local context because it is not on stilts, because it is using mostly plastic, and once again, it is very hot inside. So that's what we looked at. To have a flat pack that can arrive on site, that can be unfolded, that can start to be erected in a maximum of 45 minutes with the help of two people only, and to provide a safe environment, naturally ventilated, and that can even start generating electricity. So we looked at the different dimensions. So you see 6 square meters is very small, but it is just enough for a family from 5 to 6 people to be inside, to sleep, and also to start recreating the community around. So the roof eave that you can see, solar panels on the top, an inflatable kind of balloon at the back to collect water. And in terms of structure and envelope, so we are currently working on this prototype. We are starting to build it because it has to leave to Venice in less than 2 months. So the skeleton is a very simple aluminium structure to be lightweight and with panels that are insulated against the heat radiation, and to have this net that is on the top for the natural ventilation to ensure that inside it is comfortable to stay in. And after that, we do have all of the energy to generate energy, so solar panels on the top. We are not talking about generating electricity in the entire town. It is just sufficient to charge a mobile phone, which is crucial during a disaster. People need to be connected to help each other. So the electricity that is generated here, it is to charge a telephone, but also to use a little bit of electricity at night, because when it is the night, people are more scared, which is part of the recovery process. So this very small shelter is something that we will be developing, commercializing with the help of Singapore and some other foundations. It's presented in the Venice Biennale to show to the rest of the world as well what we do here in the local context. that in Singapore, in Southeast Asia, we are developing some projects that are adapted to the region, adapted to us. So that's what we are showing there. And to have something that is a bit more playful and happy than those horrible 10 that they are sending here, or even those IKEA. I'm not complaining about IKEA, they are doing good things at some point, but their disaster relief shelter is simply horrible. It looks like a temporary house that can be demolished very easily. So we are trying to do something that is colorful and that is helping the people to recover on the short-term period, and also on the long-term period, all of those elements can be dismantled and reused for a new construction. So all of the members, the panels, the structure, everything can be reassembled to help for reconstruction. So that's how we develop a more sustainable project with very simple elements that are taking references from vernacular architecture. So along that line, we developed this other project. So it's quite a funny story. So we wanted to engage the communities in a participative action. So we worked on this mobile lotus for the Tonle Sap Lake in Cambodia. Last year, a group in the UK, they did this competition, this international competition, to design a mobile floating platform for the Tonle Sap Lake. So, do you know the Tonle Sap Lake? So, Cambodia, going up and down, the tide and so on, wonderful ecosystem, World Heritage Site from the UNESCO. Unfortunately, it is so successful that many people are going to live there. And many people are going to live there basically to fish, because there are so many fish that there are fishing, all of the fish. The thing is, by doing that, they are destroying entirely the ecosystem. So here we have those wonderful pictures. It's beautiful. Look at that, like the nice life and the nice ecosystem. I will not show you what is happening now, but this is the dream pictures, the simple life of the people. But it is not like this at all, because it is overpopulated. You have houses on stilts all around the lake. All of the floating villages that are going in the sanctuary during the breeding season. And so they are fishing while fish are supposed to breed and to reproduce. So because of that, there is less fish. They are intensively... Okay, that's... sorry, it's references. They are intensively using agriculture, using pesticide all over the lake, which basically kill the fish. The water is no longer oxygenated and there is no longer fish. So it's a true disaster what is happening there, and it is next door. It is beside Singapore. So again, what can we do from Singapore to work there? So we looked at traditional architecture and to work within this geometrical composition. And so this is what we proposed, to have this mobile lotus. I will explain to you later why we call that the lotus. So it's a construction that is very simple, that is using wood, local craftsmanship, local material, and to build that with the communities and to offer them a kind of public space that is floating, and that all of those floating villages can go and be attached to this kind of public space. And what is happening inside, it is to educate the population, to show them how to have a more sustainable lifestyle. And how can we recycle the water? How can we use some plant to filter the water as well? And how can we reoxygenate the lake? So from a polluted water to a clean water, through a short-term process and through a long-term process. So that competition, interestingly, we lost it. We lost it. I was like, okay, too bad, we lost it. Like, we did a lot of work because we studied all of the different processes on how can we clean the water, how can we reuse some of the waste, generating gas, some solar panels, the water, how can we filter it using some different plants and to have those floating gardens and so on. So we're very happy about all of that. Very promising. We did a lot of study, research. We're not researchers like you guys, but we are doing our research. and we lost it. I was like, okay, too bad, we lost it. So I contacted the organizers because I was like, hey, you know, I know we lost it, but do you have any contact there? Because I would like to maybe try to build it with some local communities anyway. And the guys were extremely happy. They were like, oh, we were waiting for your call. You were having the best project, but we couldn't award you and so on. And so now we are working on this project to build it. Because those guys, they really want to build it as well. So we are in touch with some other NGOs, with UNESCO as well, to ensure we are not doing bad things for the lake. We are engaging schools from Singapore as well, SUTD, TP as well, and some other schools from Europe, to do workshops from October to December to build that with the local communities, because we believe that can really help in making that lake better. So it's a short term and a long term that we are looking at it from a 10, 20 years, what can be done in 20 years from now. So this is the simple construction. So using local wood, using some barrels at the bottom to make it floating. And even now, the organizers, they put us in contact with a local hospital to have a kind of mobile hospital. So we are not looking at a very complicated hospital. It's basically some beds to provide very simple medical treatment. But it is just to go and reach the people who are living on the lake and who cannot go to the different medical zones or from the hospitals. So that's what we designed, and we are now working on all of the details to build it with the local communities. So the reason why we call it the mobile lotus, it is to have a skin that can easily open for the ventilation, to bring natural ventilation inside, to have something that is, of course, comfortable to stay and to stay for a long time inside with the local communities. So that's a close-up where we can see how those houses can connect to it and to welcome everyone inside this mobile lotus, and even to transfer the knowledge that we initiate something, and we will transfer that knowledge to the local communities for them to be able to build it, maybe in a smaller scale, maybe in a bigger scale, and to have more, because this lake is gigantic and it is not just one that is needed. We will need 10, 20 of those different structures to reach a maximum amount of people. So inside we do have this kind of auditorium, mini auditorium, like to welcome everyone, to give some courses about how can we recycle different elements and to have a more sustainable lifestyle. And here we are not talking about a LEED certification or green marks. Here we are talking about a true sustainable lifestyle. So that's what we are developing at the office. It's beyond beyond certification that we can have in our countries that can afford for. Those countries cannot afford for those kind of certification. So we are really looking at a real sustainable lifestyle that is not, that we cannot quantify, and that it is more being with the people. And on the rooftop to have, just below the roof, to have those kind of classrooms that you can see from one side to another. So on the opposite side of those smaller scale projects, so we worked on this on another project, which is to develop an urban ecosystem to reenact humans with their immediate environment. So it was almost 2 years ago, we were invited to work on this project 2050, the vision for the future of Asian metropolises. You might know this project. It was done with Surbana. So Surbana is a very large architecture firm in Singapore. I'm sure you know them. And so they invited us to take part of this project, Project 2050, which was the vision of what could be our Asian metropolises 35 years ahead from now. The whole process was extremely interesting, because usually when you are architect, you will work after an urban planner, an urban designer. You are given a plot, and you do whatever you can on that. That was a reverse system where all of the different disciplines were all mixed together. The architect, the urban planners, the infrastructure engineers, environmental engineers as well. And we worked on that ideal plan of 1 kilometer by 2 kilometer that looked like Singapore. And that all together, it was a kind of give and take. How can we work together that it is not the architect who are requesting for things or the urban planners who are imposing ideas? It is how can we work together to develop something that is more holistic and that it's a shared development. So we looked at this project, and little by little, it became something that is more dense because we were looking at a high density piece of metropolis with towers that can go as high as 400 meter high, knowing that in Singapore it is not yet the case, but we were thinking of maybe in a Singapore context we will be able to go as high as 400 meter. So from just a basic planning, it became something extremely dense. So it might be frightening, so when we look at that, but we were really exploring that to see, is it livable? Can we do a city that is livable when you have such a high dense city? And so some of the different groups or the different teams were developing iconic projects, fun projects. Some were universities, some were addressing the sea level that is rising, some were working on a vertical agriculture, some were doing weird stuff like this W thing that was supposed to be a hospital, a wellness, so hence the W. So it's a little bit tacky, but okay, why not? So those were this group of architects, and us, we did a project that is right in the center, that we had this great chance of being facing the water. So we looked at, again, very basic principle of a sustainable approach, which is the course of the sun, the wind, so how to reduce the heat radiation, how to open up more to the prevailing wind, doing different calculations and so on. So that's what we developed. And little by little, we sculpted our towers. Towers, because it wasn't just one, but it was four towers, a set of four towers that can help each other, that can collaborate, and that can one can protect another one. So it's again a sort of give and take. So that's what we looked at. So we called that the tropical pyramid because it looks like a pyramid. Of course, the developer will tell you that this is not feasible because it is too expensive, but we are not looking at a developer. We're looking at something that is more idealistic to develop something that can be dedicated to the people. And so that's why looking at the heat stack, the ventilation, the wind, how can we open up the towers at different level and to open that for the people, to insert public facilities at different level. So the whole purpose of this exercise with all of the rest of the team was to do a layered city where almost as if you can live at the level 75 and you go to your neighbors at the level 60 and so on without touching the ground. Is it the future? Is it what we want to live? Do we want to live inside those kind of cities in the future? We don't know, but it was exploring. So that's why we're inserting those public facilities at different levels. And that's what you can see, where we have those green zones that different program can be directly associated with that. We looked at a simple construction method for the facade, a prefabricated system that can be assembled like a Lego, something that can go on the facade, and basically people can even customize their own place. So you can buy maybe just a slab, and after you can assemble your own facade. So it was, how can we make a city that is more organic, organic in the way of thinking, organic in the way of inviting the people to customize their own towers or their own apartment with what they want on the facade? Do they want to have curtains? Do they want to have a glass or a balcony? But every time to ensure that it is providing some sun shading to protect the inside of the spaces. So that's what we ended up with, in having this kind of stack of multiple element of program. So of course, some housing and some other public facilities, some elevated garden. The big green connection that you see here were elevated MRT system that were at different height. So those were developed by the urban planners. And so of course, we were plugging on that and to develop that even further, and how to connect from one tower to another using those elevated gardens. So it's a bit of a sci-fi view, but maybe it's what will be our cities in 2050. So that's the view, that the reason why we were opening up the towers in this direction, it was to ensure that the prevailing wind can penetrate deep inside the towers and even get the fresh air from the water to bring it inside the towers. And the very big tower that is facing the sun is shielding the smaller towers on the behind, and this tower to have sufficient sun shading devices to protect the inner spaces. So this is on the complete opposite side of the scope of a sustainable approach, from a very small scale of disaster relief shelter to mobile lotus and to a super high-rise building. So I will, okay, that is the principle with all of the different sustainable element. So in conclusion, I would say observing global, thinking regional, living local. So yes, we live in a very much globalized metropolis city. We are in Singapore, in the middle of Southeast Asia. So yes, we are connected to the entire world. We are connected to the region, and we are always trying to maybe copy whatever is happening outside. Instead of copying, I would say we need to observe global and to think, because we are in a region. We are not disconnected from the rest of the region. So thinking regional to see how can we help the other countries, our neighboring countries, where they need help. And of course, living local, because we are embedded into a local context. So we have this virtuous organic element where everything starts to blend with each other, to think global, even think local, and so on, from one idea to another, to have something very organic in terms of a sustainable approach. Thank you.